I now give the floor to Mr. Vladimir Voronkov.
Mr. President, Excellencies, I would like to start by expressing my sincere condolences to the governments and people of all member states which have recently suffered from any form or manifestation of terrorism. My heartfelt thoughts and sympathies go to the survivors and the families of the victims. Tomorrow, we will commemorate the 4th International Day of Remembrance of and Tribute to the Victims of Terrorism with the participation of the Secretary General. Let us work every day to prevent and alleviate the pain and suffering that terrorism causes. I thank the Security Council for the opportunity to present the 13th report of the Secretary General on the threat posed by Daesh to international peace and security, and the range of United Nations efforts in support of member states in countering this threat, as mandated by Security Council Resolution 2368 of 2017. I am pleased that Assistant Secretary General Michelle Konings is joining me today, unfortunately only on the screen, to present this report, which our offices prepared jointly with the analytical support and sanctions monitoring team led by Mr. Edmund Fitton Brown. I take this opportunity to salute the excellent work of the monitoring team, which recently produced its own 28th report on the threat posed by Daesh and Al-Qaeda. Mr. President, we all are witnessing the rapidly evolving situation in Afghanistan, which could have far-reaching implications for peace and security around the world. It is therefore welcome that Dr. Dawood Moradian will also brief the Security Council today. I would like to echo the Secretary General's appeal to the Security Council earlier this week to use all tools at its disposal to prevent Afghanistan from being used as a platform or safe haven for terrorism. Let us remember in this regard that several members of the Taliban remain designated terrorists according to the Security Council Resolution 1988 sanctions regime. I also note the concerns expressed by some Security Council members with regard to the release of prisoners affiliated to Al-Qaeda and Daesh. Despite the latest developments in Afghanistan, the Secretary General's 13th report on Daesh remains valid. Its emphasis on the interplay between armed conflict, state fragility, and terrorism, and Afghanistan is no exception. The report also notes that Daesh has expanded its presence in Afghanistan. We will need to ensure that Afghanistan is never again used as a launching pad for global terrorism. Globally, the threat posed by Daesh to international peace and security during the period under consideration has remained significant and steady over the past 6 months, raising serious international concerns. Daesh has continued to exploit the disruption, grievances, and development setbacks caused by the pandemic to regroup, recruit new followers, and intensify its activities both online and on the ground. Its core in Iraq and Syria has still access to significant hidden financial reserves, estimated between 25 and 50 million American dollars. Daesh has decentralized its governance further, and the additional autonomy, capacity, and confidence gained by its regional affiliates could provide the group new options, including to orchestrate international attacks and shape the future global impact of Daesh. COVID-19 related lockdowns in many areas were more comprehensive in early 2021 than in 2020. But it's conceivable that attacks have been planned for when restrictions ease. There is an increased near-term threat of attacks by lone actors or small groups inspired and possibly directed remotely by Daesh, including online. Only through cooperative measures between and within countries, including civil society and the private sector, can we counter the terrorist threat online. I welcome in this regard the first ever high-level debate held last month by this Council on cybersecurity, as well as initiatives taken at the regional level. Mr. President, Daesh remains focused on reconstituting its capabilities in Iraq and Syria, organized in small cells hiding in desert and rural areas that wage an insurgency against security forces while they move across the border between the two countries to avoid capture. However, it is the lack of a comprehensive solution to the situation of thousands of individuals with alleged links to Daesh who remain stranded in Iraq and Syria that could shape the future terrorist threat landscape over the medium to long term, not just locally, but globally. The conditions in detention facilities and displacement camps in northeast Syria have further deteriorated, especially in Al-Hol camp. Several instances of escapes, terrorist radicalization, fundraising, arms smuggling, training and incitement continue to be reported, as well as killings and enforced disappearances. Thousands of children caught in this limbo through no fault of their own continue to have their rights abused and violated on a daily basis. I welcome the efforts of member states that have repatriated their citizens since my last briefing to this council in February. But the pace is too slow, considering the scale of this humanitarian, human rights, and strategic security priority, which only grows more complex as time passes. And I think because of this development in Afghanistan, it could create even more dangerous environment in these camps with unpredictable consequences. I reiterate the Secretary General's call upon member states for the voluntary repatriation of all concerned individuals, with particular focus on children, in line with international law and with the consent of relevant governments. Next month, we will formally launch the global framework that my office coordinates with UNICEF to facilitate all of UN support to requesting member states on the protection, voluntary repatriation, prosecution, rehabilitation, and reintegration of individuals with suspected links to United Nations designated terrorist groups returning from Iraq and Syria. We have already begun employing this framework mechanism in support of Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, and Uzbekistan, and a scoping exercise has been undertaken to support Iraq. Mr. President, the report of the Secretary General describes that the most alarming development over the past 6 months has been the spread of Daesh in Africa, with spillover from Mali into Burkina Faso and Niger, incursions from Nigeria into Niger, Chad, and Cameroon, and from Mozambique into Tanzania. A global response is urgently needed to support the efforts of African countries and regional organizations to counter terrorism and address its interplay with conflict, organized crime, governance, and development gaps, as underscored by a wide range of member states during the second counterterrorism week that we held from 28 to 30th of June this year in New York. Daesh's affiliate in the Greater Sahara has killed several hundred civilians since the beginning of the year in large-scale attacks in Mali, Burkina Faso, and the Niger. Its so-called West Africa province will likely gain from the weakening of Boko Haram. The situation in the wider region could be aggravated by the relocation of terrorists and other foreign fighters from Libya. The expansion of Daesh in Central Africa and especially in northern Mozambique could have far-reaching implications for peace and security in the region and need to be addressed through a coherent regional approach as a matter of priority, as the group's affiliates may seek to exploit intercommunal disputes and illicit trafficking activities. In Europe, the threat from Daesh has continued to be suppressed by pandemic-related restrictions. The threat of terrorism attacks by lone actors radicalized and incited online, especially vulnerable youth, remains the primary concern along with terrorist radicalization in prison. Mr. President, Assistant Secretary General Konings will brief you shortly on the support provided over the past months by the United Nations system to member states in addressing the threat posed by Daesh. My office has continued to work closely with all our partners to ensure business continuity during the pandemic and advance the implementation of our global programs and projects tailored to address the needs of member states. These efforts are supported through our presence in the field as requested by member states, including our Program Office for Counterterrorism and Training in Rabat and the Program Office on Parliamentary Engagement in Doha, which we launched in June in partnership with Morocco and Qatar, respectively. Our global program on detecting, preventing, and countering the financing of terrorism in response to the Security Council Resolution 2462 of 2019 leads on a joint initiative with the Global Counterterrorism Forum to identify and disseminate good practices to effectively counter terrorist financing while safeguarding civic space. The United Nations Countering Terrorist Travel Program, led by my office, to help member states establish advanced passenger information and passenger name record system in line with Security Council Resolution 2178 of 2014, 2396 of 2017, and 2482-2019, now counts 43 beneficiaries. The program held three virtual assessments for Djibouti, Mongolia, and South Africa, and interactive online trainings for Sierra Leone, the Gambia, and member states of the Southern African Development Community. We also completed a series of virtual study visits to Belgium, Colombia, Norway, the Russian Federation, and Spain for the beneficiaries of our global program on national-level interagency coordination mechanisms, or fusion cells, and launched in January a new global program on countering terrorist threat against vulnerable targets. Mr. President, 2021 is a year of milestones in the international fight against terrorism. The time couldn't be better for member states to recommit themselves to multilateral action against terrorism under the auspices of the United Nations. 20 years ago, in the wake of the 9/11 terrorist attacks by Al-Qaeda, the Security Council provided momentous leadership and guidance with the adoption of its landmark resolution 1373 and the establishment of its counterterrorism committee. Today, we face transnational terrorist threats like Daesh and Al-Qaeda that are enduring and able to adapt to new technologies, but also expanding to include individuals and groups that commit terrorist attacks connected to xenophobia, racism, and other form of intolerance. Unity leadership and leadership from the Security Council remains as critical today as in 2001 to confront terrorism in a sustained, collective, effective, and principled manner that upholds the rule of law, human rights, gender equality, and safeguards humanitarian action. This year also marks the 15th anniversary of the United Nations Global Counterterrorist Strategy and the 10th anniversary of the United Nations Counterterrorist Center in my office. I was highly encouraged, therefore, by the success of our second counterterrorism week in June, during which member states actively engaged in the second high-level conference of heads of counterterrorism agencies convened by the Secretary General, and the consensus adoption of the General Assembly of a comprehensive and forward-looking resolution for the review of the global counterterrorist strategy. This bodes well for our collective efforts and bad for Daesh and other terrorists. The United Nations system, through the Global Counterterrorist Coordination Compact, stands ready to support you and all member states. I look forward to the guidance from this Council as we transition into a new decade for counterterrorism. I thank you, Mr. President.